Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of the pastors here at the Rock.
Well, tonight I got a simple message for you. It'd probably be a little bit short tonight, but a simple message. But before I tell you what I want to talk to you about, let me first talk to you about simple. All right? Simple message. Let me talk to you about simple. I think oftentimes as Christians, you and I miss out on the big things that God has for us for the little. And what I mean by that is oftentimes you and I get consumed with the big things in life, the next big opportunity coming our way. Maybe the next endeavor I need to embark on. I mean, after all, this is a new year, right? And probably there's many of you out there that are have made a New Year's resolution. And I'm not saying today that there's anything wrong with that. I believe in New Year's resolutions. I believe God does too. Okay, but we get so caught up with the big things in life that we miss out on the little things. We miss out, in other words, on the simple instructions that God gives to us in His Word to live out our day-to-day lives. Where if we will put those to practice, we will find that those little things will lead us to God's big stuff and big blessings and big successes and big victories. Maybe tonight, you know, I know I've heard a lot of talk, you know, watching news, you know, here you can invest in this stock and you can invest in that stock. And if you make this big purchase, you're going to gain this asset. And it's all this big stuff. And again, we're not against big stuff. We're not against being ready for the next opportunity, embarking on new endeavors. But if we do that at the expense of the simple things God gives us in His Word to do day to day, then really we're missing out. I know that as a young man, one of the questions that kind of haunted me, and I share this with the youth all the time, is as a teenager and as a young man, people would come and ask me, what do you want to be when you grow up? I hated that question because I never knew what I wanted to be when I grew up. And I struggled, and I went back and forth with that for a while. And so thank God for Godly Family. I go ahead and pray, and then I open up my word, and I'm ready for God to speak to me. You know, thus says the Lord, Joseph Aaron, you shall be a pastor at the Rock for such and such amount of years. And that never happened. I found simple instructions for my day-to-day life. I said, okay, God, well, I'm just going to have to do that. Can I give you some tonight? Simple instructions that if you do will bless your life. How about this? Give thanks. Hey, if you've ever wondered what God wants you to do today, if you want to know what He would say to you today, one of the things that He says to us is He says to give thanks. Let us by Him continually offer up the sacrifice of praise, which is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to His name. And if we'll just go ahead and do that on a continual basis, it'll yield great fruit and great blessing into our life. Amen. How about this one? Jesus says, hey, I want you to watch and pray. I know we're going real deep tonight. I know this is like blowing your mind right now. But I want you to watch and pray. And I think, you know, how about this? I'll be the first one to admit today that there's been times in my life where my prayer life has got pushed to the back burner because I'm trying to make sure that this happens. I'm trying to make sure I'm over here. I want to make sure that these things are taken care of. And I'm missing out on the blessings of God for the big things. Are you hearing me today? A couple more. I got a few more I want to share with you. How about this? Come to church. I'm so thankful all y'all. This is not for you because y'all in a church today, all right? So just go ahead and you can think about somebody else tonight who's not. No, I'm just kidding. No, don't do that. But all right, I'm so thankful you're in church today because, you know, the Bible says, let us not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, which is just come to church. Thank God for senior pastors taught us, you know, if you want to grow in your relationship with God, if you'll be in church twice a week, you'll grow and you'll be blessed in your life. It's a simple thing. How many of you can come to church? Well, you're here, so I know that you can. It's a simple thing that will yield great blessing in our life. Let me meddle for just a little bit, all right? Is this all right? Husbands! Love your wives. Husbands, that was a good place for the lady to say amen. Amen. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave Himself for it. It's a simple thing that if you practice day to day, will cause your marriage to be a success. Well, you know what, Pastor Joe, I got this. See, you don't understand. I got this sweet vacation plan this year, and I'm going to go to Hawaii. And you know what, I got some stuff going on in my marriage, but, you know, I'm just believing that we're going to go, and it's just going to be a blessing. We're going to come together, and just everything's going to work out. Well, hey, listen, I'm not against trips to Hawaii. I don't think anybody here is, and neither is God. But if I'm focused on that, and I'm expecting that to make the difference in my life, and I'm neglecting loving my wife, I'm going to miss out on the successful marriage for the big thing. Well, you don't understand, Pastor Joe. I'm married to the Wicked Witch of the West. I even think I seen her turn green one time. Well, you know now from God's word, and because you've seen the movie, what to do with the Wicked Witch of the West. You want to get a big bucket of God's love, and you want to douse your spouse in the morning and in the afternoon and in the evening. And when you get all done, go ahead and do it the next day. And before you know it, the bitterness and the resentment and the strife is going to come melting off the both of you. Don't shout me down while I'm preaching real good. Come on now. You know it's true. Come on, let's have fun tonight. Everybody turn to your neighbor and say, douse that spouse. Somebody hashtag that. Douse that spouse. All right, now to be fair, I got to tread even more lightly with this one. Wives, respect your husbands. Have you ever tried? Listen, I know your husband's a jerk. I know he doesn't lift a finger in the house. But have you ever tried treating your husband like the man you want him to be? Let me say that one more time. Have you ever tried treating your husband like the man that you want him to be? Because before you know it, you put God's word to practice and you respect your husband, and that knight in shining armor is gonna come forth. Hello, somebody. Maybe it's not 20 extra hours at your job that's going to get you the promotion. Maybe it's just simply working as unto the Lord and not as unto man. All right, so I got a simple message for you today that I don't want you to put aside because it's simple. I want you to know that if you practice what we're going to talk about, you're going to be greatly blessed. I want to talk to you tonight about rejoicing. Rejoicing. If you brought your Bibles, go ahead and turn to them with me to Philippians chapter 4, verse number 4. And if you're taking notes, the title of the message is this. It is, Let Us Rejoice. Let the people of God rejoice. Philippians chapter 4, verse number 4, we gain a simple encouragement from God's word to us for some things that we need to do in our lives, for actually a thing that we need to do in our lives, and that is to rejoice. This is what the Bible says, Philippians chapter 4, verse number 4, it says, Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. What does God want from me today? What does God have for me today? What would he have me go and do? Well, he wants you to rejoice in the Lord always, and again, rejoice. The word rejoice means this. The word rejoice means to be glad. It means to, I like this, take delight. I like this one. It means to take joy. I'm here to tell you today, people of God, that there is joy for you in your situation. There is joy for you right where you're at if you're willing to be glad. And if you're willing to take delight, and if you're willing to take joy, as the Bible says, in the Lord, there's great joy for you. Listen, God never intended for you to live a miserable life. God never wanted you to be broke down, busted, and disgusted. I like how Pastor Jim says it. God doesn't want no sourpuss Christians. People look like they've been sucking on lemons all week long. There is joy for you in the Lord. And God intended that your Christian walk be a walk of great joy and great delight and great gladness, regardless of what you're going through. The Bible says this, that the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. There is joy for you. We just had Christmas, right? Did anybody here remember what the angels said to the shepherds? They said, Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. Listen, this gospel message is a message of joy. This Christian walk is a walk of joy. Our faith is a faith of gladness. If today you're willing to take it, God has joy for you today. And what if rejoicing was the key that you needed to get you to where God has for you? What if rejoicing is the factor that will make the difference and cause you to fulfill what God has for you, cause you to receive what God wants to give to you? Let me say this. I heard this recently, and it was a blessing to my life, and I want to share it with you, and then I want to add something to it. But I was listening recently to a preacher, and they were talking about, you know, it's New Year's, and they're talking about New Year's resolutions, and as we said, New Year's resolutions are not a bad thing, okay? But what they said was, you know what, all right, so you got a New Year's resolution. You've heard from the Holy Ghost. You've got some direction. You know what you want to resolve in your life. You know what you want to build. You know what you want to do. That's great. But he said, but I want to help you, because if all you have is a resolution, then this year is going to come and go, and that resolution is going to be left unfulfilled. If you got a resolution, that's good, but you need to develop a routine in order for your resolution to become a reality. If you got a resolution and you want that resolution to become a reality, you're going to have to develop a routine. I've said for many years, I would love nothing more than to gain about 15 pounds of muscle. It's never happened. And that's because I've never developed a routine. You understand? So I've got a resolve. I've got a resolution. That's great. Okay. Now, in order for that to become a reality, I need to develop a routine in my life. All right. Now, this is what I want to add to that. I know no better way than to fulfill my routine than to do it with rejoicing. Hello. Once I got the resolution, I need a routine. And now that I've got the routine, I got to rejoice in my routine. And the rejoicing is going to carry me through so that not halfway through my routine do I give up, but I fulfill the whole routine and the resolution becomes a reality in my life. I don't know a better way to go through life than to do so rejoicing. Matthew Henry said, I got this quote here. It says, holy joy will be the oil to the wheels of your obedience. Joy and rejoicing will be the thing to carry you through wherever that you at until completion. All right. So maybe that was a little bit fancy. I mean, after all, Matthew Henry, he's like, centuries old. So let me see if I can break it down for you in San Bernardino. All right. Joy, rejoicing, being glad, taking delight, taking joy will be like the salsa to your burrito. Come on. It'll be the syrup to your pancake. It'll be the butter to your bread. It'll be the ketchup to your hot dog. It'll be the cheese to your patty. Come on. It's going to help you down anything that comes your way, all right, so that you overcome in Christ Jesus. I know that's goofy. I know that's silly, but I think that you get the point, all right? When I rejoice in my routine, it carries me through. It's that oil to the wheels of my obedience. You know, what's really interesting is as I was looking over this message, I actually, because I was nervous, last night I couldn't sleep all that well, and any little noise my dog made, he's waking me up, any other time I would have slept right through it, but so I was up and I was thinking about different things, and the Holy Spirit began to show me something and brought a verse to my remembrance, and I came to see that, and I want to share with you, did you know that joy was one of the things that aided Jesus in enduring the cross? It says, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and today is seated at the right hand of God. Hello, somebody. You need some joy up in your life today. You're going to have to learn to take delight and be glad and get the joy of God in your life. Now, if you contrast Jesus' story with that of the children of Israel, everybody here knows the story of Moses, all right? Do not go see Exodus. It was a terrible movie. I hope it's okay for me to say that. It was terrible. Terrible. Don't waste your money, all right? Because it's not the story of Moses. About halfway through, I leaned over to my cousin. I'm like, what movie did we come to see again? Because I don't know what I'm watching. All right, but you guys know the story of Moses. You're in church. You're good Christian people, all right? And the story of Moses is that God, brings this great leader to deliver them out of Egypt. All right, terrible slavery. They were enslaved 400 years. All right, backs split open. They were fed, the worst to eat. They were given slums to live in. Their children were put to death under Pharaoh. And God comes along and he brings this man and uses this man by the name of Moses to deliver them. And so he delivers them out of Egypt. And first, Moses wanted to take them to meet up with God, right? Because before Moses took them to the promised land, he first wanted to introduce them to the promiser, right? You got to get first things first, all right? But nevertheless, it was about an 11-day to 2-week journey from Egypt to the promised land. These people ended up spending 40 years in the desert because rather than take joy, they'd rather take opportunity to complain. And rather than take joy and be glad, they'd rather take time to get frustrated. And in fact, there was one time where actually they rose up and they said, let's kill Moses. We're going to stone Moses and we're going to stone Aaron and we're going to go back. Can you believe? I would take the desert before I took Egypt any day. Are you hearing me today? But without joy, look at, if it wasn't for God and if it weren't for Moses, they would have gone back. What I'm saying to you is, if Jesus did his life with joy, how many realize I need to do my life with joy? And we see clearly in contrast that without joy, I run the risk of giving up halfway in my routine and going back instead of moving forward to where God would have me to be. All right? So, rejoice in the Lord always. I just got 2 points for you tonight. All right? 2 points, 2 things to remember about rejoicing. Number one is this: rejoice always. Rejoice always. Look at Philippians chapter 4, verse number 4, one more time. And this is what it says. It says, rejoice in the Lord. And the next word is always. What does always mean? Always means always. In all times and everywhere. In the good times and the bad times. You got to rejoice. In fact, I would probably emphasize a little bit more the bad times. We need to make sure that we're rejoicing in the Lord. The Bible says, count it all joy, brethren, when you fall into various trials, right? Paul talked about in Acts chapter 20, he said, you know what, I don't count my life dear to myself so I can finish my course with joy. You'll find all throughout God's word, you know, the difficult time is really, you know, show you where you're at spiritually, if you can be joyful in the middle of your trial. But so the Bible tells us, encourages us to be, to rejoice in good times and bad. Now, what's so interesting about what Paul says here, actually, Paul, of course, is the writer of the book of Philippians. Paul was actually in prison when he wrote this letter. He was on house arrest. And actually, he had been in prison for a number of years and had been transferred. And then there was a transfer of leadership. And then finally, he went ahead and said, you know, I'm a Roman citizen. I'd like to just take my case before Caesar. And so he went on this journey, and he was shipwrecked. I mean, his life was on the line. And here he finds himself giving his case before Caesar. And he writes this book of Philippians to the church at Philippi. And did you know that in 4 short chapters, this book is only 4 chapters long, he talks about joy and rejoicing 14 times. 14 times Paul from prison talks about joy and rejoicing. How many of you think today that if he could do that from prison, if he could be joyful and if he could be glad, if he could take joy from prison, how many of you think you could take joy in your situation today? You got reason to take joy. So he says, he says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. All right? So some things to remember about rejoicing. I've got to rejoice always, at all times, in the good times and the bad. And then tonight, point number two, and this is our last point, is this, that in order for you and I to delight, in order for you and I to take joy, you and I need to rejoice in the Lord. All right? One more time. Let's look at Philippians chapter 4, verse number 4. It says this. It says, rejoice, and I think this is the key, in the Lord. Always. And again I will say, rejoice. See, when we're in difficult times, when we're in difficult situations, I don't necessarily believe that God is asking us to rejoice in those negative, in those bad decisions. I believe that God rather is looking for you and I to rejoice in the Lord in the middle of our situation. Because see, in the Lord there will always be reason to rejoice. Right? That's the key. Rejoice, he doesn't say just always or in anything. He says, he's very specific, and he says, rejoice in the Lord. And no matter where you find yourself, there will be a reason to rejoice. You know, Paul the Apostle comes along and he says, you know, I don't count my life dear to myself so I can finish my course with joy. And he knew that very soon his life was going to come to an end. Yet he was still rejoicing. Why? Because he was rejoicing in the Lord. And Paul knew, and this is what he is quoted as saying in 2 Timothy. He says, hey, Timothy, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. And watch what he says. And now there is in store for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall award to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who believe upon his name. He had a reason to rejoice even when facing death. Jesus had a reason to rejoice even when facing death. Hey, it doesn't matter where you're at today. I'm here to tell you, people of God, you have a reason to rejoice. You've got the promises of God. God is your defender. God is on your side. He's faithful. He loves you. Come on, he's got a plan for your life, a hope, and a future, and God will see to it that he'll work everything out for your good. Amen. You've got a reason to rejoice in every situation. I so love the story of Joseph, not just because that's my name, probably a little bit because it's my name, but not just because it's my name, but just because it's such an awesome story. Because Joseph comes along and Joseph had a dream. Anybody out there ever had a dream? Right? Joseph has a dream. He decides he wants to share his dream with his family. So make a long story short, he gathers his parents together, all his brothers together. He's like, hey, everybody, I had a dream. Anybody ever had somebody else come up to them and share with come up to you and share with you that they had a dream and you were in it? And it's always kind of like awkward, like, all right, what happened in that dream? I hope it was good, right? So like, okay, so they gather around, and he's like, hey, I have a dream. And guess what happens in the dream? And they're like, what? He's all y'all, you're going to bow down to me one day. And it went over just like how that went over right now. And they were like, okay, all right, Joseph, you've lost it, and you need to be quiet. And eventually what happened is his brothers got very bitter, so they decided, you know, we want to kill our brother over this. He's got favor with our father. He's having all these dreams. I mean, and one of the brothers essentially talks them into, all right, rather than killing him, how about we just sell him to slavery, all right? And so they drop Joseph in a pit, right? And they drop Joseph in a pit, and some slavers come by and they sell Joseph, and he's carted off. And back in that day, if you were sold into slavery, you were done, you were gone, you weren't coming back. All right, and so he goes off, he's sold to a man by the name of Potiphar. Potiphar was an Egyptian soldier, and he goes to work in Potiphar's house. And the Bible says this about Joseph, that Potiphar noticed that everything that Joseph put his hand to, it prospered. In fact, he didn't even know what was going on in his house. He just knew that everything that Joseph touched, it prospered. So he ended up putting Joseph in charge of everything, right? So Joseph's running everything, and he's prospering, right? And next thing you know, well, Potiphar's wife is unhappy. She thinks Joseph is hot, and so she comes up, and she's like, come on, let's get it on. Right? And he says, you know, he says, how can I do evil in the sight of God? So he backs away. So one day she corners him, and he takes off running. She gets a piece of his clothing, right? And she goes and basically accuses Joseph of rape to her husband. Well, you know what any husband would do, right? You're ready to kill the dude who just assaulted your wife, all right? So Joseph is thrown into prison now. He's there in prison, and he's there for a number of years, and then these two people come from the house of Egypt out of Pharaoh's service, and they're in prison. There's apparently something came up, and they were brought into question. Well, while they were there, they go ahead and they have dreams themselves, and so they tell Joseph their dreams, and Joseph ends up interpreting them. And one of them got put back into Pharaoh's service. The other one ended up being executed. But he told the one who was going to get put back into Pharaoh's service, hey, remember, when you go back, remember me. Well, he was forgotten for another couple years, right? So then all of a sudden, Pharaoh has a dream, right? And Pharaoh, and this is really disturbing, so he gathers all of his wise men, all the people that would counsel him, and he tells them the dream, and nobody can figure it out. And then all of a sudden, the one man who Joseph interpreted his dream in prison remembers Joseph. And he says, hey, you know, I was in prison in such and such a place, and there is this man. His name was Joseph, and he interpreted my dream. I had a dream, and I told it to him, and everything that he said came to pass. So Pharaoh's like, what have you been waiting for? So he goes ahead, and he says, you know, bring him to me. So he brings Joseph, and Joseph goes ahead and hears out Pharaoh's dream and then interprets the dream. Pharaoh knows that it's true, and so what Pharaoh does is he exalts Joseph to second in command in the entire nation of Egypt. In fact, he said, if you actually read it, he said, you are over my entire family, and nothing shall be outside of your authority except for my seal itself, unless I want to step in and do something. So I'm almost seeing this as he had more authority than even Pharaoh's wife. Of course, I don't know what kind of authority women had back then, but you understand what I'm trying to say. He's exalted, right? And then Joseph goes ahead and he gets married and he has a couple of children. And I love the name of one of the sons. One of the sons was Manasseh, and the name means this: for the Lord has caused me to forget my trouble, my pain. And the Bible is recorded of this. It's recorded in the Bible saying this of the story, that what his brothers and his family meant for evil, God meant for good. So essentially what happened was his brother sold him into slavery. All right, Potiphar's wife lied on him. He got put into prison. He was forgotten. All these evil things that happened to him, though people meant them for evil, God meant them for good. It was first meant for evil by people, but then it was second meant for good by God. And what I'm saying to you today is you have reason to rejoice no matter where you are today, because God will turn your situation around for your good. Come on, somebody. Listen, it may have been years that you've been suffering, and there may be some stuff going on in your life that's going on for a long time, and you just don't understand. It just seems to get worse, and you're wondering, God, I thought I heard you. I thought I had your dream. I thought I had your direction and everything. Hey, listen, God's about to turn it around for your good. And the Bible says in Romans 8:28, and we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, who are the called according to his purpose. And I love that so much. And we know, not we hope, not we wish, not we think, we know. You know, it's really kind of powerful, because in another portion of scripture, Paul's like, you know, we see dimly in a glass. And one day we'll see face to face, and all this cloudiness and all this, you know, this prophecy and these different things that we're struggling to understand and figure out, it'll be wiped away, because then we'll be with Jesus face to face. But one thing I figured out, and that thing is for sure, I know God will work all things out for your good, for you love God and you're called according to his purpose. So you have reason to rejoice tonight. You have reason to rejoice, because you can rejoice in the Lord. Psalms chapter 5, verse number 11, if you guys will just pop it up here on the screen for me. Psalms chapter 5, verse number 11, it says this, but let all those rejoice who put their trust in you. Let them ever shout for joy because you defend them. Let those also who love your name be joyful in you. And then I forgot to put verse number 12, but it says this: for you, O Lord, will bless the righteous. With favor you will surround him as with a shield. So tonight, people of God, though simple, vital, necessary for you and I to carry out what God has for us, you and I need to rejoice. We need to be glad. We need to take delight. We need to take joy. And today, if you're wondering where you can take joy in the Lord. There's always a reason to rejoice in Christ Jesus. So what do you say tonight? We go ahead and put the word of God to practice. I'm not going to tell you how to express your gladness, but I want somebody in the house of God. Come on. If you got something good from God's word, you want to see him do great things in your life, come on. Why don't you rejoice and be glad and let God fill your heart with the strength? The joy of the Lord is our strength. A merry heart does good like a medicine. Come on, there's joy for the battle. There's joy for the journey. It will carry you through. Come on, it's the icing on your cake. It's the ketchup on your hot dog. It's the oil to your wheel. Come on, you want to get where God has for you to get? Come on and rejoice today. You can't afford to patty cake your praise tonight. Come on now. Come on, get out of yourself. We give the Lord some praise. He's worthy. He's going to do something good in 2015. Well, tonight, just got a really one more thing I want to talk to you about before we let you go. And that is your eternity. Where will you spend eternity? The Bible's very clear. There's only two places you can go when you die. It's heaven or it's hell. There's no in-between. There's no coming back as a frog, as a dog, anything like that. It's heaven or it's hell. So tonight, I think it would be wise for all of us to take an examination of where we're at with God. And I want to ask you a question, and I want you to answer it in your heart sincerely. And your answer is going to show and reveal where you're really at with God tonight. And that question is simply this: God forbid, but if you walked out of this place and tonight was your last night here on the earth, you walked out of this place, you got in your car, you got in an accident, and life was over for you, where would you end up? Would it be heaven or would it be hell? Now tonight, if you answer that question, you said, Pastor Joe, man, I really hope I'd make it to heaven. I mean, I don't want to go to hell. I want to love you enough to tell you the truth tonight. You need to get right with God. You can't hope your way into heaven. You won't find that anywhere in the Bible. In fact, why would you take such a chance with your eternity? We're not talking about your life. Everybody here would agree that a life decision, a decision that would affect the rest of your life, would be a very important decision. We're not talking about, you know, 24 hours worth of consequence. We're not talking about a week. We're not talking about a year. We're not talking about a lifetime. We're talking about eternity, a time that will never end. Why would you take a chance like that? I think that you're wiser. I love you enough to tell you the truth. You can't hope your way to heaven tonight. Tonight, if you said, you know what, Pastor Joe, if I died tonight, I think I'd make it. Well, I want to love you enough to tell you the truth. You can't think your way into heaven either. It's nowhere in Scripture. You won't find it. As if, you know, you can achieve a certain level of mentality and that somehow, you know, opens a door for you to make it to heaven. This is not some psycho-cybernetics, New Age guru goofball message. You know, you think and you get there. You believe that you're going to get there and you're going to get there. That's not how it works. You don't get to heaven because you think that you're going to make it. Now for just a moment, let me go ahead and give you the benefit of the doubt. And let me just go ahead and ask you, what makes you think that you're going to make it? Well, Pastor Joe, I'm a good person. I can't tell you how many times I've heard that. I've talked to people about Jesus outside of church. Oh, you know, I'm good. I'm going to heaven. Well, why are you going to heaven? Because I'm a good person. You know that nowhere in Scripture does it say that good people make it to heaven. In fact, if you really want to be honest about what Scripture says, the Bible doesn't call us good people. We were all in need of a Savior. We all needed His blood, Jesus' blood to be shed and His body to be broken to remove sin from our lives so that we can make it back to the Father. We are not good people. We fall short, the Bible says, of the glory of God. If good people could make it, God never would have had to send Jesus. But He sent Jesus because there was no other way. There is no other way to make it. You're not going to make it to heaven because you're good. Today, you don't make it to heaven today because you're in church. Coming to church is a great thing, like we talked about tonight. We do wonders in your life, so long as you hear God's word and you respond. All right? And I want to love you enough to tell you the truth that you don't get to heaven because you're in church. If it's no different, is you know, as much as I like basketball, as much as I like the Lakers, if I showed up to the Staples Center and got on the court and tried to play, that doesn't make me a Laker. I get arrested, they cart me off to jail, and I'd be on the news. Rock church pastor tries to be a Laker and is in jail today. Are you hearing me today? So just because you come to church doesn't make you a Christian. Just because you're born in America, just because you're not another religion, just because your family is Christian doesn't make you a Christian. Just because grandma prays for you does not make you a Christian. Just because you've been baptized does not make you a Christian. You have a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. You got a Jesus tattoo. Doesn't make you a Christian on your way to heaven denying hell. You can't hope your way. You can't think your way. You can't be good enough. You can't be religious enough. All right, Pastor Joel, well then how do I get to heaven? I'm glad that you asked. Because the Bible is very clear. The Bible says this: those who are headed for heaven are those who have given God all of their heart and given God all of their life. So the question tonight is not so much where you would end up if you died, but rather, who does your heart and who does your life belong to today? Because unless you can look me in the eye, better yet, unless you could look Jesus in the eye one day and say, Jesus, I gave you all my heart and I gave you all my life. Sincerely, I want to love you enough to tell you the truth. You need to make that decision today. You need to get right with God. You need to be on your way to heaven, denying hell, by giving Jesus all of your heart and giving Jesus all of your life. Who does your heart and who does your life belong to today? Does your heart and life belong to you? Because it can't. Does your heart and life belong to the world? Because it can't. What does that mean? It means the world influences you. You're really following the world. The world is really lord of your life, dictator of your life, ruler of your life, the thing that governs your life. Listen, today we're not asking for perfect people, but we are looking for people who ultimately have given all of their heart and given all of their life to Jesus Christ, have his blood for the remission of their sins, and are following him to the best of their ability. So who does your heart and who does your life belong to today? Unless you say, Pastor Joe, it belongs to Jesus Christ. I want to love you enough to tell you the truth. You need to give it to him today and switch directions. Be on your way to heaven, denying hell. And I heard a powerful example one time I want to share with you. And the example is an example that we're all familiar with, and that is the example of the Titanic. You guys have all, everybody seen the movie. Did you know the Titanic was warned 3 times before it hit the iceberg, split in half, and lost all those people? It was warned 3 times. Oh, but this was the ship that could never be sunk. Hey, listen, we just want to let you know that there's the weather's not good, and we're concerned that it's going to be hazardous for the ship. We really think you need to change direction. We really think you need to change course. They ignored it once, twice, 3 times, and we know the rest of the story. And after it was all said and done, somebody took a line and drew it down the middle of a piece of paper. On one side, they put saved. On the other side, they put lost. My question to you today is, when this is all said and done, on which side of the piece of paper will you find your name on? When God draws a line, and on one side he puts saved, and on the other side he puts lost. It's your call today. It's your choice. How many times will you be warned before it's too late? Where are you really at with God? This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to count to three. I'm going to hit my hand on my Bible just like this. When I do, if you need to give Jesus all of your heart, you need to give Jesus all of your life today, I just want you to simply slip your hand up in the air. I'll see it, and you can put it right back down. Let's be clear. What you're saying by the raising of your hand this evening is, Pastor Joe, that's me. I want to give Jesus today all my heart. I want to give Jesus today all my life. I want his blood to wash away my sin, and I want to follow him the rest of my days. And you know what's so cool? God will give you the strength to do just that and fulfill your commitment. So on the count of three, come on, if that's you from the front to the back, don't worry about the people that are around you. They're not going to stand next to you when you give an account before God one day. Come on, let's be real. And probably most people in this house today want you to make the decision if you need to. So come on the count of three, if that's you, you get your hand up in the air. What you're saying is, Pastor Joe, that's me. I want to give Jesus today all my heart, all my life. I'll see your hand, and you can put it right back down. 1, 2, 3. There's 1, 2, 3. See 4 wise people, 5, 6. 6 wise people. You guys can put your hands down. Didn't embarrass them, not going to embarrass you. 6 wise people. Pastor Joe, that's me. I want to give Jesus today all my heart. I want to give Jesus today all my life. 6 wise people. Ushers, help me. I saw those hands back there. I think that's 7 and 8. Thank you. God bless you. Didn't embarrass them, not going to embarrass you. About 6 to 8 wise people in the house today. Come on, if you're sitting in your seat wondering if you should, you should. That's God dealing with your heart. Come on, don't turn them away. You don't know how many opportunities you're going to get before it's too late. 6, 7, or 8 wise people today. Didn't embarrass them, not going to embarrass you. Anybody else tonight? Anybody else tonight? Is that a hand? Yes. Okay, another hand. Praise the Lord. All right, let me look over you guys one more time. One last time. Don't miss your opportunity. Come on. I didn't embarrass them, not going to embarrass you. It's about 8 wise people tonight. Anybody else? Anybody else? It's not too late. Anybody else? All right, well, praise God for the 8 wise people in the house this evening. Hallelujah. Boy, you know what the Bible says? It says, don't rejoice because the demons are subject to you, but rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Those of you who raise your hands, you have a reason to rejoice tonight. All right, let's do this. Let me have everybody stand to your feet. And the eight of you who rose your hands, and anybody who didn't, but you know you should have, I want you to go ahead and grab your purse, your coat, a sweater, whatever you brought with you. Bring a friend if you need a friend. I want you to come right down here. I want to shake your hand and congratulate you on the best decision of your life.
Jesus, I believe in you. Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I breathe. And Jesus, I believe in you. You're the reason that I live. The reason that I breathe.
All right, check it out. Best decision of your life. Hey, listen, this is a time to rejoice. This is a time to celebrate. So go ahead and put a smile on your face. Hey, this is the first day of the rest of your life. You're going on with God. Life will never be the same again. Amen. God can do it in your life. All right, this is what I want you to do. You'll go ahead and look to your left, my right. This is Pastor Joel, PJ Primetime 2. Just kidding. And he's going to take you right back over there. He's going to lead you in a prayer to give God all of your heart and all of your life. You don't get saved just by raising your hand. The Bible says if you believe in your heart and you'll confess him as Lord with your mouth, the Bible says that you shall be saved in that moment. So he's going to lead you in a prayer to do just that. It's going to take a few moments. Nothing weird goes on. I promise you, everybody here says they're the weirdest person. I think I got... I mean, douse your spouse, really? All right, so if you'll go ahead and make a left-hand turn and follow Pastor Joel right back over there. He's going to give you some free stuff, tell you about a program we have as you come back. Hallelujah! Praise the Lord. The angels rejoice over one.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.